Alleluia. 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 Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. We are going to worship a bit while we wait for our friends to join us. Glory to Jesus. Quickly, 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 please help me to invite people. Click on the invite button and help me invite as many friends. We want to talk single, being single in the Lord today. Amen. So if you know somebody who is single, interested, you know, in a topic like this, help me quickly invite friends. I asked you to quickly share this video on your timeline. Quickly share this video on your timeline. Begin to comment, begin to put likes, show me some love. Amen. Connect with me, connect your friends, invite your friends. Invite as many friends as possible. I need you to show some love. Give me some thumb up. You know how it goes, right? Because the more you comment, the more you respond, the more you invite people, the more you press the like button, the more you press the love button, the more we are going to have us a party with everybody. Amen. Help me quickly put this video on your timeline. Share it as, you know, as much as you can. Share it. God bless you. The Zone, Christus, Sister Sherry, God bless you. God bless you. Thank you so much, Pastor Ike Chuku, my own brother, all the way from Brazil. Love you. Let's invite friends. Let's comment. Let's press like. Let's press love. Let's comment. Share this video. Invite friends. Invite friends. Amen. We're going to listen to this worship while we wait for our for the group just to build up. Amen. Let's invite friends. Hallelujah. This song I was singing yesterday, and it just released such an anointing in my life. God is great. He does miracles that are so great. Amen. So build up your spirit while we wait for our friends to join us. Hallelujah. Help me invite friends. Help me invite friends. I'm going to see if I can invite also. Help me invite friends. Invite, invite, invite. I'm trying to invite here. Share this broadcast on your timeline, okay? Just click on the share button. Hallelujah, glory. He is great. God is great. Come on, somebody. Come on, invite somebody. Invite somebody. Are you guys hearing me? If you can hear me, say yes, we can hear you. Please, if you can hear me, say yes, we can hear you. Invite somebody. Can you hear me? My daughter is just coming home, so what's the? Can you guys hear me? My daughter just came from school. How many of you know that he is great? Hallelujah. I don't know how the light in my house is, but it's kind of dark. Is it dark? Is it dark? Invite friends. God bless you from Germany, Bonn. Germany is in the house. Serena, God bless you. Help me invite friends. Sister Ushi Dushi, Can you hear me? Is it dark? Is it dark? Can you see me? Because the light is so bad. Okay, it is light. It is not dark. Okay, thank you so much for confirming. Are you guys hearing the worship? Come on, let me see you comment. Let me see you press the like button, the love button, you know, make some noise, you know, show some activity while we wait for our crowd to build. Amen. While we wait for our crowd to build. Come on, do something. Thank you. Oh, Sister Alice, thank you. She says I'm shining. Thank you, Jesus. Love you so much. Thank you so much. Can you hear the worship? It's so awesome. It's so awesome. God deserves the glory and the honor. I'm just trying to also invite people while we are waiting. We are going to talk single today. Amen. We are going to talk for real, heart to heart. So what I want you to do is to prepare your questions. If you have any questions, just begin to write them down. Thank you, Sister Sherry, for sharing and inviting people. It doesn't matter what is happening in your life, God is great. God is great, amen. It does not matter what is happening right now in your life, God is great. I just need you to be sharing some love, some likes, some comments, because the more you press on the like button, the more you press on the love button, the more people are going to see that we are active and they are going to join us. Amen. Invite people. Invite people. Invite people. I think it's really time for the singles. How many of you believe so? Because we say so many things, we do so many things, but we don't really pay attention to the singles. And I really believe it's time for the singles. If you believe in time for the singles, just write down there, it's time for the singles. Because we need to make some noise to let people know that we can't leave the singles behind. Amen? We can't leave the singles behind. Just type for me right there, it's time for the singles. I'm going to be sharing also my personal testimony, you know, on being a single. Hallelujah. Oh, bless you from Nottingham. God bless you. I'm going to share to you people. I'm going to be so real today with you people. I'm going to be honest. I'm going to come clean because I am a single woman. And I know what it is to be in Christ and be single. So I really want to deal with this. Come on, share and invite. Share and invite. It's time for the singles. Come on now. Let's proclaim it. It's time for the singles. Somebody needs to pay attention to the singles. And we need to get this thing out. Hallelujah. If you guys are ready for the word, you let me know that you're ready. Somebody give him praise. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Glory to Jesus. Glory to Jesus. It's time for the singles. Hallelujah. Glory. Serena, I love you so much. Mwah. I love you so much. Oh, Sister Divine, God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. I'm going to tell you some secrets about me today. Thank you, oh beloved divine, thank you so much. Okay. Okay, so now we are going to go into the word. God bless you too. Father, I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you for my friends who are online. I thank you, God, for what you are doing. Let me lower this thing. Father, we bless you. I see Shami is online. Shami, God bless you. God bless you. You are welcome. Today is time for the singles. Amen. So let me just pray. Father, we just bless you. Father, we glorify you. Father, we worship you. We give you all the glory because of who you are. Come on, help me. Join me to pray. Come on, prepare your heart in the Lord. Because God is going to speak to you today. He's going to speak to you. Because of who you are, Lord. That's why we are here, Father God. We bless you. Worship you, Lord. Because of who you are. Because of who you are, Father. You give us strength. You give us grace. You give us hope through you, Father. You remain faithful. You remain God. You remain King. You remain Lord. You remain sovereign, God. We just love you, Abba Father. And we thank you for this afternoon that we are going to come together as the people of God, whether married or single, but we want to talk about the singles, oh God, because we know you have a place for everybody. You have the singles also in your heart. So we thank you, Lord, and we bless you, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus. Come on, clap for Jesus. Hallelujah. Because of who he is, amen. So today, I just had the burden because I noticed that so many singles are going through so many things. And it is as if we in the church, we are not paying enough attention to the issues of singles. And I think a lot of singles are struggling because it's become almost like a sin or a curse when you want to talk about your single status and how you feel and all the things that you are dealing with. Come on, if I'm blessing you with this message, I want to see activities. Amen. Because I don't, you are not here, so I cannot see your faces. So I can only know that you are getting me by you liking doing something. Amen. So also being a single woman, I feel as if as a minister of God, I have the responsibility to help you. For real, because I'm not just talking about a single woman. You have to know and understand that I am a single woman. Amen. I am a single mother. That's a different level. It's different when you are just a single woman, and then when you are a single mother, that adds another responsibility. Is somebody with me? So, but then I'm not just only a single woman. I'm not only a single mother, but then I am also a single minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That brings another weight onto it. Amen. So why am I telling you this? What I'm trying to say is that I truly understand you from all levels. Amen. I truly continue to share, continue to like and love and invite people. I understand you, whether you are a single woman without children, I understand you. I've been there. If you are a single woman with children, I understand you have been there. If you are a single woman with children and a minister of the gospel, I understand you. I am there. Amen. If you are a single woman and you are young, I understand you. You know, because I've been young, I'm not that old, I'm not that young, but I've been everywhere. I've been young, I'm older now, and I'm getting older. So I understand you on all levels. And I know that when you are dating in the world, when you are not in Christ, you know, dating is very easy. Being single is very easy. Why? Because in the world, there are no rules. You meet somebody, you like somebody, you hook up. You do whatsoever you want with the person. There are no guidelines. Your feelings and your trust towards the person are the only guidelines. Amen. There is nobody judging you. There is nobody looking at you. There is no pressure. So you can. You can. I'm going to talk for real today. Are you guys ready for some real talk? I'm just going to say it as it is. Amen. When you are in the world, you are dating, you can meet a guy. If you like him, you can kiss him the same day. True or not? Come on, let's be honest here. If you are in the world, you meet a guy or a girl, you like her, you like each other, you can be intimate if you want, but that's the world. Amen? So that takes away the pressure. That takes away the pressure. But when you are in Christ, you are a child of God. There are guidelines. You just can't be kissing people. You just can't be hugging and rubbing and loving on people when you meet them. You always have to remain pure. You always have to remember that you are the temple. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. So that brings a kind of pressure. But you know, whether you are in Christ or in the world, it does not change the fact that you are a woman. Amen? Or you are a man. You are a human being. And I think one of the things that is really messing up the church and a lot of people, and some of you are trapped, is because you think because you are in Christ, you stop being a human being. So you're trying to be spiritual at all levels. You think that it will not rain on the righteous and rain on the unrighteous. But it does rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. What am I saying? What I'm trying to say is this. Whether you believe in Christ, you are Holy Ghost filled, blood wash, speaking in tongues, you have feelings. Can I hear amen? You have feelings. You have emotions. You know, something is wrong if you are living there and you have no feelings and no emotion. God didn't create you to be like, you know, numb. It's okay to have feelings. It's okay to have emotion. Amen? You are spirit, you live in a body, you have a soul. Amen? So all of those different parts of your life is in function, and there has to be a very, very healthy balance. Amen? But when we are in Christ, we spiritualize everything, every move of the body and senses and all of that. As a woman, you are weak in your emotions. Women always looking for love. Women always looking for protection. Women always looking for, compliments. You know, the whole world can tell you how beautiful you are. But when you don't have that one special person telling you how beautiful you are, it's like nobody has told you anything. We are wired like that. Is that blessing somebody already? And I'm sorry to shock some of you today. I told you I'm going to be real. You have hormones. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let the church say amen. You as a person, a woman, you have hormones. It's not the devil. You are not cursed. You are not living in sin. You are not about to go to hell. You have hormones and you have cycle. Okay. If I'm blessing someone, please say hallelujah. If I'm blessing you, say hallelujah. Okay, I told you I'm going to be transparent because I am a woman being a single woman, being a single minister. I love the Lord. I pray a lot. I fast a lot as much as I can. I live, you know, separated from the world. I focus on the things of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. But guess what? As spiritual as I am, as holy as I want to live, as you know, as speaking in tongues as I am, sometimes my emotions, they go all over the place because I'm single. I also need comfort. I need love. I need, sometimes I feel like I just need that, male comfort, like compliment or something, or just the strength of a man to be next to me. I don't have that. And then guess what? Let me shock some of you. I am a minister of the gospel. I really live in the Lord. You know, I don't play carelessly. Because I am a woman, I have a cycle. There is a period every month where you as a woman, your cycle and hormones begin to play up. Amen. You are not demonized or you are not witched by anybody. It's not witchcraft power controlling you. Because of that cycle, I have marked there's a particular 4 or 5 days a month in my life that I really feel like, oh God, help me. I feel like because you are a woman, you're supposed to produce, and in that time when you're supposed to produce, your hormones are playing up, you are fertile, you begin to feel like you need to mate with a man. Amen. You feel that the need for intimacy. Is somebody getting me? Amen. You feel it's a natural thing. There is not always spiritual, people of God. There is also biological things happening in your body. There are chemical things happening in your body. Is somebody with me? So when you begin to feel that, don't feel condemned like, oh God, I feel like I feel a little bit like I want to be intimate with somebody, with a man. As long as you are not constantly being lustful in your mind, you are not living in a place where you have lustful imaginations. It is okay to have those feelings. But now the only thing is, how do you master those feelings that come on you every now and then? You feel like you would like a man to hug you. You would like a man to kiss you. Yes, kiss. You would like a man to be intimate with you. How do you master that? Come on now, if I'm saying something great, you better tell me hallelujah. Because I'm trying to help somebody here. I'm being transparent. I decide to take this fire because I think that you need to be helped, because demons are not attacking your mind. You are a woman. And let me tell you something, and you are a man. If you are a man or a woman who has been in a relationship before, if you are a man or a woman who have had sex before, when you stop having intimacy, it just doesn't go away. Amen? Because you have tested it. Oh, glory. I'm going to speak anyway, whether the devil likes it or not. I'm going to tell the truth. Amen? You know the feeling of how it is, what it is to be held by a woman or a man. You know what it is to be touched, to be kissed, to be intimate with a man. So your body is used to that feeling. Your mind has a memory, amen, of that feeling. You even sometimes have the memory of a perfume or the scent of certain things. It just doesn't go away because you are in Christ. Come on, let me bless somebody today. Amen. It just doesn't go away because you are in Christ. It sits on you, and it is a process to come out of it. Come on, glory to Jesus. I'm talking to, I know I'm helping you people. You can say amen or hallelujah or don't say nothing, but I know I'm blessing you. I know you are receiving your deliverance right now. Amen. When you have known what it is to be intimate, it just doesn't go away. Amen. It stays on you. You have to master, you know, when you have been with a partner and you separate, it takes time to let go of the feeling of intimacy. Because number one, you have a soul tie. Don't forget, you have a soul tie. It's like drugs, you know. When a woman and a man get intimate, something happens to the brain. You release certain chemical, biological things that happen. So it's like drugs. When you are not having drugs anymore, you go through a withdrawal season. Withdrawal season where you feel like, oh, I want it, I need it, and you are all itchy, you are all, you know, sensitive, you are like irritated, you are like you know, you are sad, you are down. It gives you different kind of emotions. Amen. So don't feel bad if you are in that place. It's going to take time to come out. Don't feel condemned if you are in that place. It's going to take time and process for God to purify you, for God to sanctify your mind, remove the imagination, remove the taste, remove the feeling. It takes time to get there. But even when you are there, there is still the chance of you, because of the biological things in your body. For example, men don't have to think about naked women to wake up in the morning time and have certain feeling or reaction in their manhood. Amen. It's just like that. They are wired like that. They can be 12 years old, 14 years old, 15 years old, preaching and fasting, but they wake up like that. There is nothing demonic about it. It's you can't pray it away. Amen. It's like you can't pray your hunger away. You know, there is food, natural food, and there is physical food. And everything that God gives has something to take care of it. Every problem has a situation. When you are thirsty, you drink water. True or not? When you are thirsty, you drink water. When you are hungry, you eat food. Amen. When you are tired, you get a rest. You take some rest. So when you begin to feel like you need intimacy, it is natural. The Bible even says it. Instead to be burning, get married so that your sexual needs will be met. But the only problem is with single. You just can't jump and marry anybody simply because you have feelings and urges and all of those things. Because marriage is not all about intimacy. There is more to marriage than just being intimate. You have to think of the purpose of God coming together, compatibility, you know. There's more to marriage than just coming together to be intimate. Amen. So, and to be married. So you can't just marry somebody because you feel like this. Then other problems will rise up, and then when the problems rise up, because you'll be emotionally down and drained and not liking the people, because intimacy is connected to emotions, especially for women. Amen. So you will still not enjoy the intimacy. So do not ever choose a partner simply because you want intimacy. You have to allow God to choose for you. You have to allow God to prepare you. And you have to have a broader view of why you are with that person, of why you want to be with that person, why you want to get married to that person. Because in relationship, things can happen. Amen. But so while you are single, for me, what happened is, I have already mastered that at certain times of the month, because of cycle and different things, I can feel like really I just need that male, you know, fellowship or whatever. And I want to teach you about triggers, things that help me. You can ask me, Evangelist Claire, what are the things that help you to keep your focus? Now, I'm going to be clean and real with you today. Okay, there are triggers. You have to be honest with yourself, the kind of man or the kind of woman that you are. Some women are sensitive towards certain things, and some men are sensitive. I call them triggers. For example, I am a very, I can be very romantic if I have a partner, and certain things just get to me. For example, music. Music is one of the things that got me going in a particular direction in terms of being romantic, and you know, it kind of made me mellow when I listen songs, and you know, I get a funny. So what is happening when I hear love songs? It kind of made me feel like, I wish I had somebody. I wish I had some of that. It gets me really emotional and down. I begin to dwell on the fact that I wish I could have that love, that sensation, all that comes with relationship, but I don't have it. So what do? I avoid songs that will get me to that place of emotion, because remember, there are spirits behind every song. Amen. There are spirits behind worldly songs. The spirit of God is behind gospel songs. Amen. And even some gospel songs are tricky, because now we are mixing the world and the church together. So you have to be careful with that. Let me explain. I have some African worship songs that I like, not worship, praise songs. They get you really going, you know, African, and you're dancing and you are shaking. But I remember every time I put one of those music in my car, I go in the flesh. Somebody say hallelujah. Somebody just say hallelujah. If I'm telling you the truth of what it is, just say hallelujah. When I put one of them music and reggae kind of gospel things in my car, you should see me shaking in my car. And then I know that there is something about that music that is not totally submitted to God. There is something about the flesh in that song that is mixed and covered and tried to be like it's God, but it's not God, because it gets to my flesh. I begin to almost do bubbling in my car listening to gospel music. Oh, come on, I'm being transparent here, people. So you better help me. I'm being transparent. So you better have to know that not all music, even though they say it's gospel for real that is going to take you to the throne. All gospel so-called music don't take you to the throne. Some take you to the wrong throne, the throne of your flesh, your throne of sin desire. Amen. I was listening to one so-called gospel praise and somebody gave me, and it brought my mind back to when I used to backslide and go to the club. It reminded me of one of those club music I used to dance to, and I saw myself shaking, you know, and I was like, hey, wait a minute, where this come from, you know? So I had to like put it off the window, because I know every time I get there, I get a little and I begin to think of all those old, you know, your homies that used to go to the club with you, and so you don't want to get there. Am I being transparent enough? You don't want to get there. So choose your songs wisely. Those are triggers. I could be fasting and I hear one of those songs of Mariah Carey in the shop, and my mind is just going, want to go Hollywood. So you need to protect yourself, because I know I have that weakness. I have a soft spot for certain songs. They get me crazy. You know what I mean? So I avoid, I don't play those songs in my car. I don't play them, because no, the Bible says flee from sin. So you need to learn how to flee. Don't be too super duper spiritual thinking, no, you know, it's okay, I'm so safe, it doesn't matter. It matters. It's getting into your soul, it's getting into your spirit, it's getting into your mind, and it's messing you up and leading you to imaginations. Because everything, even those who masturbate, okay, I'm going to be honest, those who masturbate starts from your mind, imagination, feelings. It starts from certain sensitive things in your spirit. You feel like things are just, you know, pinching you all around. And then it begins to go to your mind. You begin to meditate on it. And the more you meditate on it, you begin to manifest the thing. That's why people masturbate. Somebody say hallelujah. If I'm blessing you, say hallelujah. If I'm blessing you, say hallelujah. Masturbation just doesn't come because you just sit and say, oh, let me do it. No, it starts with certain feeling in you. Amen. And then you begin to imagine. Some of you don't have pornographic films in your house, but your mind is a whole warehouse of pornographic movies because of the ungodly imaginations that you could be praying and all you are seeing is those pictures. I've been there. I'm telling you plain, because I've been there. It took the Spirit of God. It took the power of God and constant bringing my mind to God to purify me. I'll be praying and I'll be thinking about, you know, something. So you need to be honest with yourself. Like, okay, I'm dealing with this weakness. The imaginations, number one. You need to capture them. Bring them under the obedience, the power of God, the Spirit of God. Pull down those strongholds. Remove. You have to say, God, purify my mind. Purify my thoughts. Purify the things that you see. Also bring, let me tell you something. Can I be honest right now? I've been fasting the past days. And I went on Facebook. Boom. When I came on Facebook, somebody had put some pornographic images on the time and feet, you know, or whatever. So I did, my eye just flashed on it. And I said, my God, Jesus, I put it away. And I refreshed to get it off. But don't you know, just that seconds of what I saw, when I was about to pray and I closed my eyes, I saw the image. That's how easy it is to be entangled with a lot of crazy things. So we always have to constantly bring our minds. The things we hear are important. Amen. They build up images in your mind and your spirit. The things you watch also, they bring up images in your spirit and imagination that may want to lead you into that place of thinking, oh, I wish I had my own boo. I wish I had this, my husband. And you begin to feel like everybody else in the world is happy but you. Okay, there are some married people who ain't getting none. Okay, so there are some married people who just jacked up. They're not being all lovey-dovey. They're not all hugging, and some of them sleeping. One man sleeping in the garage, the other one sleeping in the store or whatever. They separated. One sleeping downstairs, one sleeping upstairs, or one sleeping they're sleeping on the same bed, one is looking left, the other one is looking right, whatever. So don't let all this imagination thinking that the whole world is happy, but you mess you up and then you fail to wait upon the Lord. Put pressure on yourself. So what I do is I avoid all these thoughts. I avoid the triggers. Number one, music is a trigger for me. Those romantic music and worldly songs. So I don't listen to none. I may sound religious, but trust me, I don't listen to them. I don't have a problem. I'm not going to be like, oh my God, the world is coming to our end. Look at Mariah Carey's song. If it comes on TV, no. You know, God has graced me enough to be able to bear. I have enough shield, but I don't practice it. Amen. If I'm somewhere, everybody in my family, for example, is not safe. So when I go to mine, it could be my brother's house, my cousin's house, because they are not safe and they are not living with God the way I do. They play their worldly music. I'm not going to reject my family, my brother or sister, because they play something. I'm going to be there, but I'm going to shield myself. And I know that it's like that. I go there and enjoy family birthday with family. Amen. So it's not like we have to run away from everything. Music is a trigger. So get those music off. Don't be watching all those MTV things and Rihanna, and they're shaking themselves and they're singing all that rub me down and, you know, pull me up, all kind of music. It doesn't help you. Can I get an hallelujah with somebody? So right there, right for me there, watch out for the triggers. Watch out for the triggers. Number two trigger for Claire Reveal is romantic movies. Okay. Romantic movies. I'm not talking pornography. Pornography, safe or unsafe, I don't watch them. Amen. But it is so funny that when I watch one of those romantic music or movies, I get down. That's a trigger for me to begin to think like, oh God, everybody else blessed but me. You know, so you have to be honest with yourself and know your triggers. Like, why every time I watch certain things or listen to certain things, I get down? It's because there are triggers that go into your feeling. It triggers certain emotion in you. So you have to pay attention to the triggers. When you go to happy couples meeting, you come back home and feel suicidal, then why are you going there? If it's a trigger for you to stop being able to wait upon the Lord, because what you want to do is be able to wait upon the Lord, right? So why will you put yourself under any trouble or torment that will prevent you from waiting patiently upon the Lord? The Bible says one of the things that all single people need to deal with is the waiting factor. Somebody say waiting factor. We all have to master the waiting factor. And the best way to wait is to wait upon the Lord and to wait in the Lord. And you've got to know how to do that without anybody putting you under pressure or anything. When you have all these triggers, you know, entangling you, tormenting you, it makes it difficult to wait upon the Lord. Amen. Life is easier as a single if you avoid the triggers. Amen. So all singles have to wait, deal with their waiting factor. Somebody say waiting factor. Hallelujah. Am I blessing somebody? Am I blessing somebody today? Don't think I speak in tongues. I don't have feeling. Boy, God, I have feelings. I'm telling you, my feelings all over the place. But I learned how to avoid triggers. And I know by revelation and maturity that the whole world is not happy except me. There are some marriages I don't ever want to be part of it. As some people, I look at their marriages, I say, if that's what marriage is about, let me be single for a while. So you need to come to that place in your mind whereby you are not so desperate. You are not so like looking at every marriage picture. They are engaged and then he's knocking off her teeth at home. But you see the engagement pictures on Facebook and you want to commit suicide. Why? Why? You know? Hallelujah. Why will you want to commit suicide because you see a guy putting a ring on somebody's finger? Maybe he's engaging her and having other two girlfriends. You don't know. So be mature in your thinking. Be mature in your perspective, in the way you see things and analyze things. Amen. Why I'm saying this so openly and boldly is to help you reduce the pressure and the negative feeling of waiting upon the Lord. The Bible says, They that wait upon the Lord, they shall be what? They shall mount high. Amen. They will soar on wings like an eagle. Amen. So you want to be able to wait upon the Lord. When you wait upon the Lord, that's when the grace comes. Don't run out of the will of God. Don't run before God. Hallelujah. Don't run and try to help God. You are not Abraham. Abraham wasn't able to wait upon the Lord. Anyway, he waited as long as he humanly could. But what happened? Abraham went and took the slave girl. Amen. Went and took Hagar and then brought problem. Later, when God came with a real blessing, some people are there married to the Hagar instead of waiting for their Isaac. Your Isaac is on the way. Amen. Don't go and get Hagar before your Isaac comes and thinking that God will not show. God will show up with your Isaac. The promised man is coming. The promised seed is coming. So don't try to help God. I'm telling you people, Facebook is not a dating website. Some of you are on Facebook. All you do is try to, and I'm going to give you a scripture for that. We are going to watch that scripture together. All you do is trying to, you think it's a dating site, a new dating site. And there are crazy men messing up with your mind, chatting with you and chatting with 10,000 other women. A lot of those men you see chatting with you, they are chatting with other women. That's their hobby. Some of them is just really hobby. Can God do anything through any medium? Of course. God can use Facebook to give you a man, a woman, or whosoever. But it shouldn't be your focus. Amen? It shouldn't be your focus. And I put something up a few days ago. I said that there are women in Nigeria, so he doesn't have to get you from Europe. I know what I was saying. Some people were commenting. I was laughing. I'm no fool. You know, there are men, I'm telling you, there are men who just want to come to Europe. And girl, they're going to use you. They're going to use you and dump you and get someone from their hometown. So I'm not afraid to say it. I will say to save you. I'm not called to preach the gospel for the world. I'm called to help people. So I'm going to tell you the truth. Open your eyes. Say, hey, girl, he's telling you, I'm a bishop. Bishop my foot. You know, bishop, there is a way. The Bible says, Jesus says that the thief come through the fence. Amen. If he's coming through the fence, through the back door, you have to understand that something is wrong with that approach. Check the foundation. Check the approach. A godly man ought to approach you godly way. Amen. He ought to approach you the right way. If he's coming through the fence, something is wrong with that. But the true owner comes through the door. If he's coming to you, he doesn't want your pastor to know, doesn't want your bishop to know, doesn't want your family and nobody to know. It's your little secret with him. Just wait a while. Something ain't right. Something is cooking when he's passing through the fence. If you have to run away from your church, run away from all your contact, he isolates you just to so-called, I'm going to marry you. He's a thief. He's a thief. He's a player. He's a playboy. You need to stop chatting with that man. And if any man talking to you, talking down their wife just to be with you, he's crazy. And you will be crazy sticking with him. Send him back to his wife. Amen. Send him back to his wife. If he's married, still with his wife, he's not going to divorce her for you, girl. He just wants to get a piece of you and he's going to dump you because he's not going to give up his half for you. Have children, especially if they are pastors. Pastors have built foundation with their wives and they have congregation. They are not just going to leave their whole church, break down their whole ministry just for you. So if he's trying to get a piece of you in the name of, and don't worry, I will leave my wife, it's not going to happen. You're going to be his little old secret. And after he's used you, he will move on to the next victim. Amen. He will move on to the next victim. We all, as I'm speaking now to women, we all as women have a responsibility to make sure that our sisters do not have broken heart. You know why a lot of women are broken hearted? Because all of us, some of us are so cheap. That will accept a man no matter what. You know he's your friend's husband, friend's boyfriend, and you know, friend's fiancé, and he's talking to you, oh, you're so beautiful, you're so this, and you giving him attention. No, you ought to tell him he's out of order. Because if he does that to her, coming to you, he will do that to you, going to somebody else. He will do that to you, coming to somebody else, going to somebody else. So you need to really, really separate yourself. Some of the men on Facebook, they are lonely. They are lonely. So they're just looking for somebody to have a good conversation with. Not every man who says, hi, is your husband. Can I get a hallelujah? Not every man who says hi is your husband. Amen. If he's messed up with his wife, he's going to be messed up with you. Of course, God can do anything. I'm not putting God out of the picture and possibilities. There are some good, genuine men there because they are, you know, pastoring or they are doing something or whatever, and they don't have the time to really go out and date, just like you and I don't have the time to go out and date. So they reach out through social media to see if they can really speak to someone, because you don't want to close all doors as well. Amen. So that's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying close all doors. I'm just saying use discernment. Be a woman of wisdom. Don't rush it. Don't be so desperate. Desperation will lead you to the wrong place. And only end up in a broken heart. Amen. Be a woman enough that you know, some of you are not living outside. So what is the problem? You have a roof over your head. You have clothes on your back. You have food on your table. You have water to drink. You have your base already. Amen. So you don't have the real need. If you were living outside, I would say, wow, I understand why you want to rush. But if you already have roof and God has taken care of you this far, why must you ruin yourself just to end up in a heartbreak? And if you have to give up your prayer meetings, your time with God just to be with him, you have to know that the thief has come to steal, kill, and destroy. Amen. Because when God blesses you, the blessings of the Lord make it rich, and with it he adds no sorrow. So if he's not making rich and you are seeing sorrow all over the place, you can't even get a full 1 hour conversation with a man and he's always busy, then you have to start to check some things out. If you are already feeling so much nervousness, anguish, and so much pain in your heart, it's like you can't get a grip of him. Something is not right. Something is not right there. Why can't I just talk to you for 1 hour and we just relax and chill or chat with you? Why are you always chatting with me and then I will say hi and then it takes 8 hours for you to reply hello? You know, then you were who are you chatting with? Gosh, who are you chatting with? Why, you know, why can't I have your full attention? It means you chatting with me and Lucy and Dorothy and Susan and Pauline and all of them and Josephine and at the same time. So it takes you a while to go back through all of them to say back to me hello. Hello. It is that simple. Amen. Don't rush it. Wait upon the Lord. And I want to read. So we have the triggers. The trigger can be music. The trigger can be movies. Watch out for movies that trigger you. It doesn't have to be pornography, but it can be a romantic movie that you are watching and then you begin to cry and you are lonely. Oh, look at how he just bought her flowers. And all of those things you see in the movie, in reality, they don't always happen. Amen. All of those things you see in the movie, there are people, I thank God for good marriages. Amen. I thank God for good marriages. And you have to separate also some activities or things with culture. Certain cultures do certain things and certain cultures don't do that. Amen. So don't be crying if you want a black man from Africa. I'm not saying African men don't do. I'm just trying to make a point. Please don't get me wrong. We have good African black brothers. I mean, they spoil you. But I'm just trying to make a general point. For example, if you want an African man or a black man, it doesn't matter where he comes from, to be buying you flowers every day and carry you on the stairs. I mean, why will he want to carry you? We black women, we're already so big. I mean, some of us, come on, be honest. Don't expect the guy to be carrying you up the stairs, carrying you on his back, you know, you hoping and wishing he'll be carrying you. Carrying you what? Then some of us need to lose some weight if you want that. Be realistic. Be realistic. Don't expect your husband to be carrying you on the stairs and then carry you in the kitchen. You jump in on his back because you see it on a movie. Or, you know, and then when he doesn't do it, you are like, oh, you don't love me. You don't show me love. No. Our men, they have different way of expressing themselves. Amen. And we have like stuff. You know, and we have the behind going on. We have everything going on. You know, we African black women, we have substance. And you want the guy to be carrying you, sisters. That's not realistic. That's not, I mean, come on now, come on now. Amen. And then you want flowers every day. Some of them don't buy flowers, but they know how to just be there and protect you and love you. And some of them, because of the way they grew up, they don't know how to say, I love you. I mean, verbally. But it doesn't mean that he doesn't love you. Amen. So just look his love language. Look for his love language in different ways. Some of them, their love language is, you know, they may, if you are blessed, they may make you a cup of tea. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. They may surprise you with a Saturday dinner cooked for you or something. So don't hear, go to your work and hear all your white friends saying that, oh, the husband bought them a rose and carried them on the stairs and made them a cup of tea, breakfast in bed, and you come home and begin to beat your partner down. It's just culture. Amen. Difference in culture. Maybe his way showing you love is to, like an African, he may send some money to your mother at home, you know, back home. He may send some money to your family. He may pay the school fees of your junior sister, your junior brother. I don't know. So men have based on and women also, there are some things that white women will do that black women won't do. You know, so some things are just cultural. It doesn't mean that the person is not good. And some of us, because we came to Europe and we've been with a white person and a black person, when we get in a relationship, we begin to confuse, because now we want our black new partner to treat us like the way the white guy treated us or the white lady. It doesn't work. You have to love the person for who they are and understand culture, understand background, and move forward with that. So those things in the movies, don't get them and begin to cry, wow, I never had somebody to carry me. I never had somebody to buy me roses. You know, buy your own rose, girl. You know, buy your own rose. And you can communicate that to the person. So even in dating, communicate what you like, but don't force it gradually. You know, and you have to know your own thing that is key to you. Let me tell you an example. Every woman wants attention. Can I hear a hallelujah? One of the things of women, attention. We want to be so exclusive. We want the man to know that we are it. We are the air he breathes. You know, the sunshine in his garden and the moon in his night and the stars in his cloud and all of that. We want to hear the hello, hi, and all of that. And we are like, oh, he loves me. Look at that. He loves me. We like attention. Amen. Can I have a hallelujah? We like attention. We like when we say hello, he says back hi. Then we are feeling, oh, he's so much there for me. All of those things and blah, blah, blah. So if you are a woman who really desires that, don't fool yourself by trying to force it with a guy who never has time for you. You are going to be hurt. You are going to be disappointed. You are going to frustrate him. Because, you, listen, I also had that. I still have that. But now I'm learning that you cannot, you cannot command water to come out of a rock. Water don't produce rock. If he is a rock, take him for who he is. Either you accept him for who he is or you leave him alone. But don't go and be dating a rock when you need water. Water comes from rivers. Amen. Look for a river. There is a man or a woman who has what you need, but it is tormenting and torturing, confusing for you and confusing for your date or whosoever. When you start demanding things from him that he does not have the capacity to give to you, it's frustrating. Then he sees you like pressure because he is not where you want him to be, and or she is not where the man wants her to be. Amen. Some men, they want, oh, you are not so romantic, you are not so flexible. And some women are just very careful with how they pour their love and heart out there because they've been hurt before. Amen. So sometimes also it's about trust issue. It's like getting to know the person. So give it time. Amen. If you want a woman who is exposing her part of her breasts for men, which is not godly anyway, and you meet a woman of God that you are dating and you are expecting that, please leave her alone. Go and look for some, whatever, somewhere else, not in the church always. Amen. There has to be a healthy balance of what, you know, and a man demanding so much from a woman that he's not married to is also uncalled for. It's also uncalled for. If you want to see her breasts, her cleavage, and show this and that to you, don't call her that, oh, you are not flexible, you are not so romantic, you are so uptight. Hey, she's not. You are not married to her. Those are not the things that you ought to be having now. If you want to see everything of her, then put a ring on it. Hallelujah. So, you know, so put a ring on it, claim it, you know, put something on it, and then you can have a picture of her at any mood, at any time. But if you haven't done that, you don't own the right to demand certain things from her. And it's funny how sometimes men want to pressure women to say, oh, show me this, I want to see how you act, whether you are romantic. And they ain't doing nothing for you. If you're not paying her bills, you're not taking care of her, you don't have the right to be demanding things from her, because you are not her husband and she is not your wife yet. Amen. So we really need to adjust ourselves as single women. I'm talking to you, single women. Learn to protect yourself. Don't leave your heart all there. You know, don't let getting a relationship. I used to be there where I just wanted relationship. Amen. And then you get yourself entangled with a lot of emotional pain and hurt. And then this, you can sleep, you can drink, because one human being, God has done so much in your life. And you allow one human being to come and just ruin your whole month, your whole day. Amen. Everything you're building, just tormenting your mind, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. Amen. If you can't have joy, at least if somebody is not taking care of your bills and anything, they want, at least they can give you a little bit of joy. You can do bad all by yourself. You don't need somebody to come and add into your pain. Amen. You don't need somebody to come and add into your insecurity, making you nervous as if you are not worth their attention. If a man can't have attention, is free. Amen. Attention is free. He doesn't have to pay anything to give you attention. It's free. It's a choice that a man has to value enough to say, you know what, I want to bless her just by being there, know that I have her back. It gives you also security. So if he can give you something which is for free, what else can he give to you? Amen. Simple courtesy of just finding out how you are doing, blessing you, or just being there is for free. So if you are not even having that, then why are you even bothering yourself with the person? If somebody cares about you enough, if somebody puts enough value on you, the sacrifice they bring to the table is what we measure how much they value you. Amen. If you are worth 1,000 euros, for example, and the person is not even putting 50 cents on the table, it means he doesn't see your worth. Amen. People will pay for good product and they will sacrifice to put that money on it because they see the worth. Until he can see your worth, or until she can see your worth, they will not put in the amount of sacrifice. The level of sacrifice the person puts in will show you the level of value you have in them, in their mind. If somebody values you, okay, let me say something. A man will value you, or a woman will value you. Amen. It's like you have a diamond ring. You value that diamond ring. Will you leave it somewhere outside where anybody can take it? You'll be afraid to just leave it without checking it out or protecting it. Amen. So if you are dating a man or a woman and they don't even care to call you for weeks, just leave you there, because they don't care whether you date somebody else or somebody takes you. They don't have the value on you. So they just leave you there. You can go, you can stay, you know. So that's how much value they don't put on you. If they put value on you and they are afraid to lose you, they will put security over you. Amen. Security is what they are going to be and sacrificing their time, their attention, some maybe finances if they have it. Make sure that you are out. They want to make sure that nobody else. Men are territorial. Amen. They want to make sure that you, nobody else is crossing their territory. But if he leaves you out there and 1 month he's not talking to you, he's not finding out how you are, it's like he just put you out there. Anybody can come and take you. For all you know, you would have been gone with somebody else and he wouldn't care. Amen. So he's just coming back to check. He will go out, play with other people, then come back after 1 month, 3 weeks to see if you are still there, to give him the oxygen, because it feeds his ego to know that whenever he calls, you are available. Don't be available for fools. Amen. Do not be available for people who can put you down when they want and drop you when they want. Amen. Do not be fool for nobody. Amen. Make sure you protect your availability, because if he's not honoring the time you are giving him, why are you honoring the time you are giving him, or vice versa? Amen. I wrote something on Facebook a few weeks ago. I said, do not make a person who makes you their option your priority. You are making him exclusive. He has not even told you yet if you are his girlfriend or wife to be. But you've already declared him exclusive. You are not open for other people. You are not dating. You are not focusing on other things. God has a blessing for you. But you focus on that one person who doesn't even have your time. And you're shutting your own doors. Amen. Don't make a person who has made you their option, amen, your priority. If they make you their priority, make them your priority. Amen. But if they make you your option, you also play. You know, it's a mirror. You have to use a mirror effect. See how she or he is responding and you move. It's a mirror effect. You see what he's doing and you give it back. Amen. Do not do that. Don't waste your time with men and women. Some women are the same. Some women just playing. They just like the male attention. They like when everybody is just, you know, flirting with them, liking their pictures, liking this and liking that, and they think it's all about lust. No, that's lust. People are lusting over you. It's not like, you know, and you're like, oh, they like me. Look at, oh, that's you. You're just taking negative attention to yourself. You want to draw attention to the right people. Amen. You want the right people to show you love. You want the right people to be there for you. Amen. So is this blessing anybody? Is this blessing anybody? If it's blessing you, let me just hear a big amen. Let me just hear a big amen. Wait upon the Lord. Amen. Avoid the triggers. Know your own trigger and know your cycle. And what do you do during your cycle? When you know that every 3 weeks in every month, the third week in every month, you get the cycle where your hormones are all over the place. Amen. So what do you do? What you do is, what I do is, that's when I go out more. I spend the time with the Lord. I worship more. I get myself busy. I get myself busy, because if I just sit at home and I'm going through that hormonal, emotional state, I feel like I just need somebody to hold me or be intimate. You know, you have that feeling. What I do is I make sure that I fulfill, I soak myself in purpose. Okay, that's an important point. One of the things that is really getting me going for many years, I've been single like for ages, like forever. Amen. So one of the things that has helped me is purpose. I have purpose in God. So I'm always busy. I'm always focused. My purpose keeps me focused. Somebody say, get a purpose. Just write down. If you want to survive as a Christian woman or man, this single thing, and be strong, it's not always going to be very easy, but at least it makes it better. You have to be a man or a woman of purpose. Because if you don't have purpose in God, Satan will give you a purpose to be running with. And it's not going to be good. Amen. Why David fell, although he had some issue, is because when he was supposed to be out there with his people, warring for God and doing the things of God, he was at home. And then he saw the woman. Amen. And then took somebody's wife. You understand what I mean? So if you don't fulfill, if you don't have godly purpose in your life, things to be doing, Satan will give you a purpose that will make you to fall in God. So what keeps me focused, what keeps me strength and grounded, is because I know I have a purpose. I work my purpose. I run with my purpose. I stand for my purpose. I keep focus. I build my purpose. I build everything around my purpose. So my purpose in God has given me a strong foundation. For example, I am here talking to you now. It's part of my purpose, right? Do you think I'm thinking about feelings of how I feel? I'm single. No. I'm fulfilling destiny and I'm passing my time. By the time, you know, when I'm done with this, I have children to take care of. I have home to take care of. I have I preach all over the place. I have to study. So I don't have the space to allow the devil to play in my mind. Even though as a human, there are loopholes that he can still come in, right? Like when I'm tired, when I'm just, after I've preached my best message, I come home. I still come home to an empty house. And then you wish you had somebody to give you a cup of tea or just to ask you, how did it go today? Those little moments, the devil can, those thoughts can come, which is okay. That makes you human. Amen. That makes you a human. So you're not a superhuman being, but just know how to master it. So wait upon the Lord. Avoid your triggers. Know your triggers. If you know that when you eat sugar, sugar makes you want to feel like, want to have intimacy, while you are single, avoid it. Amen. Don't stir up things so you don't have the medication for it. When you are married and you eat sugar and it makes you want to be intimate, it's okay. You have a partner, so you can use that. But why will you put yourself under that amount of pressure when you know you don't have the husband to do anything with? Why will you want to do that? Amen. So avoid the triggers. If you know watching monkeys gets you going, don't watch monkeys. Watch chickens. I don't care. Buy a bird, something. You know, whatever triggers you, don't. And conversations, ungodly conversations. Some men, they have this thing, you know, you begin to have conversation with certain men, and then they don't mean bad, but the conversation gets you all smooth, and then your feelings are all woken up, and then, so avoid conversations that will bring you back to that place of trigger. Is somebody getting me? If you are talking with a male figure and the conversation begins to go to that direction that will trigger you to have certain feelings, you have to find a way with wisdom, because as a woman, you don't want to be too uptight as well. Amen. Usually women, we don't want to be too uptight that guys cannot, you are not accessible, you hinder every conversation, you are just boring. You know, men don't like boring people. I'm sorry. They save, but they remain men. Amen. So you as a woman need to find a balance to be, you know, be funny, be lively, be outgoing, be a woman. Amen. Be gentle. Don't be speaking in tongues when a guy calls you just to say hi, and you begin to oh shantara baba, oh rekatorekatorekatara baba. No. You're spoiling the whole date. You messing it up. Amen. Don't begin to speak in tongues when a guy tries to approach you. Be a woman. Be nice. Be gentle. Brush your teeth. Brush your hair. I mean, do something with your armpit. Spray perfume. Wear nice clothes. And you don't have to expose your body part to be beautiful. Be a woman of God. Amen. Also, don't only show the man that you have a body, but my God, you have a mind. You have a mind. God gave you intelligence. Let him see substance. Don't just be like posting yourself and this and that. All that is going to spoil later. But let have something deeper than just your body, your face, and those selfies that all of us, you know, Photoshop and take away all the acne. Let him know that you are a real woman from within. Amen. You are a real woman for within. That's what God wants us to be, women of God, who can be women, but at the same time, you know, we find the balance to be just godly. Amen. So I'm going to read a scripture with you. Is this thing blessing you? Is someone being blessed? Hallelujah. So I'm going to read one scripture with you, and then we are going to close and pray. Amen. Keep inviting people. Keep telling them that we are here. Share these videos on your timeline. I thank you for the love. I'm seeing the love. Yes. You know, I love, you know. So thank you so much for the love and the likes. Keep the comments coming. Keep the love coming. Keep the likes coming. Share this video. Invite many people. Sister Sherry, God bless you. Serena, God bless you. Sister Ushidoshi, God bless you. Hallelujah. God bless you. Oh, I love you. Trump, Sabina, God bless you. Sister Antoinette, just join us. God bless you. I thank you all for watching. You know, it's time for the singles. Come on now. Somebody proclaim it. And it's time for the singles. Amen. I believe this year a lot of you singles are going to be married. Amen. But you are going to be married to the man of your desire. God is going to open up the windows for singles. And let's protect also our married sisters by not allowing their men to come and be messing them up with us. Amen. We have the responsibility to protect marriages. Marriages are holy unto God. So it doesn't matter how single you are. If a man, a pastor, a man is still there with the wife and they are still together, their marriage is there, you know, if they may be having some problems, but they may get back together. So it's not an opportunity for you to go and sell yourself. Amen. It's not an opportunity for you to go and sell yourself like, here I am, put her away. If he puts her away because of you, in the future he will put you away because of somebody else. Amen. So we sisters need to protect each other. We need to protect godly order. We need to protect our sisters and brothers' marriages. Amen. A brother can reach out to you. I know it can be hard at times, you know, but then give him godly love him enough to give him godly counsel and send him back off to his wife. Always remember, remind him, you have a wife, she may be crazy, now it's going to be fine, and pray for him. But don't see it as an opportunity to take him away from her. That's not godly. That I rebuke that spirit. It's not godly. Amen. So if we want marriages to stand and our future marriages to stand, we need to protect marriages by not allowing us to be used by the enemies to be the one that the enemy used to break up a marriage. Amen. If it's broken before you came, it's different. But you shouldn't be the reason why he's breaking off from his wife. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying today? I mean, God is talking to us, so let's purify. Let's have standard. Come on. Say, let's have standard. Women must have standard. We must have godly standard to preserve that which is of God. Hallelujah. Glory. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. I see women rising up with standard. Amen. We are not going to be partakers of the enemy's plan. Are you guys with me? We are not going to be partakers of the enemy plan. I'm trying to put up a Holy Ghost music here because I feel God. Let's have standard, women. Come on, write it down. Say, let's have standard. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's have standard. Jesus, glory to... I'm trying to get us some music because I feel God in this house. I feel God in this place. I feel the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. Are you guys being blessed? Are you guys being blessed? Let us have some standard. If he leaves her, he's going to leave you. If he leaves her for you, he's going to leave you for somebody else if God doesn't deliver him. Amen. God forbid we should be, we've already been so long alone, so we don't need drama. We don't need to step into a relationship and releasing curse upon ourselves. Amen. So let's have a standard. If a man comes to you, he's married, send him back to his wife. Send him back. Don't condemn him, because a lot of things happen in relationships that, you know, sometimes a brother or a sister can be weak. But you just be godly enough to say, no, brother, no, sister, you know, I know you are married. Things can happen. Go back. And if somebody confined in you, when they are having their relationship problem, don't use it to blackmail them. Don't use it to condemn them. Just pray for them. Amen. Because marriages go through a lot, I'm telling you. But we must have standard. Amen. I want to read a scripture with you. I want to read the... You know why I want to read this scripture with you? Because when I'm thinking of what some singles are doing, what is causing you pain, is because you try to do everything to please a man. Amen. So I'm going to read a scripture that will give you an idea of what I'm trying to say. Amen. Are you guys with me? So I'm going to read the book of Genesis. Genesis 29. If you have your Bible there, read with me. I'm going to read Genesis 29 from verse 31 to 35. Genesis 29. From verse 31 to 35. Are you guys with me? Just write it there. Genesis 29, verse 31 up to 35. And I'm going to reveal something to you. And then we are going to close for today. Has this been a blessing to you? Is God blessing you? Hallelujah. So it says, when the Lord saw that Leah was unloved, he enabled her to have children, but Rachel could not conceive. So Leah became pregnant and gave birth to a son. She named him Reuben, for she said, the Lord has noticed my misery, and now my husband will love you, will love me. Are you seeing that? Leah was a woman unloved by her husband. She was unwanted. She felt rejected. She felt unloved, unappreciated, because she wasn't the first choice of her husband. Amen. She was actually giving to him. The father tricked Jacob to give Leah to him. So he's not like, it's not his first choice. Can you imagine? So then she gave birth, and then she named the child Reuben, for she said, the Lord has noticed my misery, and now my husband will love me. She thinks by giving birth to this child, she thinks God is giving her the child so that the husband will favor her. So she was doing everything thinking of the man. I will born a child because of him. I will do this because of him. She thinks by doing certain things, finally, she will get the love and the favor she desired. But then it didn't happen. Then the Lord, and 33 says, she soon became pregnant again and gave birth to another son. She named him Simeon, for she said, the Lord heard that I was unloved and has given me another son. This woman was looking for every means. Every time God blessed her, she thought it was about the man. She thought everything was about him because she was a woman rejected, not loved, not valued, not honored. So she was looking for means. And when God will bless her, she will think, okay, because I have this thing now, finally, finally he will notice me. Finally he will love me. Finally he will think of me. Finally he will accept me. Finally, you know, it sounds like many women, isn't it? And then 34 says, then she became pregnant a third time and gave birth to another son. She named him Levi, for she said, surely this time my husband will feel affection for me since I have given him three sons. She was birthing these sons and thinking that because she's doing all of these things for this man will finally love her or honor her or acknowledge her or, you know, be there for her. But it didn't happen. Then 35 says, once again Leah became pregnant and gave birth to another son. She named him Judah, for she said, now I will praise the Lord. And then she stopped having birth. This is a very sad story, but at the same time, an encouragement for us. Amen. This is a woman who was unloved. Like most people feel unloved, unappreciated, unaccepted. They feel pain, they feel disregarded, no attention from a particular man that they like. They would just want the man to love them, to give them attention, to notice them. They are fruitful. You know, you may think, I'm a woman of purpose. I am beautiful. I have this. I have that. Can you see? You know, can you see that I have all these qualities? So a lot of women like Leah, they go through life doing everything just to have that one man love them. They go through everything just to have that one man appreciate them. They do everything, you know, they work with him for free. They cook for him for free. They clean for him for free to say, at least he will acknowledge that I'm a good wife. At least he will acknowledge that I'm a great woman. He will acknowledge. They go to school just to prove that they can study so that he will know that, oh, finally she's a great woman with substance, but then he's still loving somebody else. Have you ever been there where you do all that you can, you do everything in your power to let this man know, I've been there for you, I am here for you, I'm birthing out things for you, I am praying for you, I am cooking for you, I am cleaning for you, I am doing everything for you. Can't you see? I am keeping myself for you. I'm not dating anybody else because I love you. All I want is your attention. All I want is your appreciation. All I want is for you to see me, to know that I am a gift to you. The other woman you have is not even half the woman I am. She can't even give birth to the things I'm giving birth to. She's not even bearing you children. But look at me. I'm giving you children. I'm here supporting your ministry. I'm here praying for you. I'm here always listening to your complaints. When you have nobody to talk to, you call me. I am here for you. I'm always here. A lot of women have gone through that, like Leah. Oh, come on. You better say to yourself today, I am not Leah. You are not Leah. You are a woman highly favored, loved and highly favored by God. Amen. You don't have to be doing everything in your life just to get the attention of a man. You don't have to go through it just to let him acknowledge you. You are a woman of substance and God has a plan for your life. Amen. God has positioned you for a reason. And God allow you in that position of being single, not wanted, rejected or whatever for a reason. Amen. Imagine I am here talking to you today because I know what it is to be single. So even in my singleness, God gives me a purpose to help single people, a purpose to support single people. So whenever God gives you a problem, leaves you in a situation, he's teaching you a lesson, he's giving you something, he's giving you a mantle, he's giving you a mandate, he's giving you lessons, he's giving you teachings, he's giving you power and authority in that place to come out on the other side and pull other people out. So don't see your single status as a curse. It's a blessing to generations. It's a blessing to many. Instead of using your gift to try to impress a man who doesn't care about you, why don't you use it to impress God? Hallelujah. Use your gift to impress God. God left you there for a reason. Imagine Leah had to be delivering children, trying to think that by having all these sons, the husband will notice her. We love her, we appreciate her, but he didn't care. His love was still for Rachel. Men or women will choose who they want to choose. They could be fools, but they will still choose who they want to choose. Amen? They can be choosing somebody you know that person is not even half the man you are. A woman can choose a man who is not even half a man you are. Or a man can choose a woman who is not even half the woman you are. And you are wondering, what's wrong? What's wrong? And you begin to feel like you are cursed. But I'm here to tell you, you are not cursed. You are blessed. You are blessed in the name of the Lord Jesus. Being single is not a curse. It's just an opportunity to get to know yourself better. It's just an opportunity for you to get to know God better. It's just an opportunity for you to get to know your purpose. Discover your purpose in God. Hallelujah. Are we still online?